Alright guys, I'm here at the Johannesburg War Museum and I'm going to show you guys some cool military history. So let's go take a look, shall we?
Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Ricky Coast. We are here at the SA National Museum of Military History. So I want to go through and see what we can learn. So come follow me. Hi guys, we are here at the War Museum with Patrick. Patrick, thank you for actually letting us come through.
Only a pleasure, only a pleasure. Yeah.
Yeah, Patrick, can you show us one of the cool exhibits around here?
Well, let's go and look at an aircraft which is nearing its 100th birthday. There are only 6 left in the world, and it's going to look at
the aircraft you were talking about.
It's nearly 100 years old. It's painted in the colours of South Africa's top First World War fighter pilot, Andrew Beecham Proctor. He shot down 54 German aircraft, and he was the British Empire's top observation balloon buster, 18 balloons to his credit. That's why we painted it in the colours of his aircraft. And when we restored it, we left the side panels off so people could see what it looked like inside a First World War aircraft, which was basically made out of wood, covered in cloth, and braced with wire. It was a fire. It burned beautifully. And the pilots that flew in them didn't have parachutes. And you can imagine the choices.
Where are we now?
Well, we are at another rear bird. This is our DH-9. They have 5.5 left.
Only 5.5.
We thought there were 3. R1, yeah. One in France and one in Australia. And then they discovered 2 aircraft bodies with 3 Cessnas.
Hence the half. Yes.
First used by the South African Air Force to bomb strikers in 1942. And this also was made by the strikers to try and counteract the government forces artillery. It must have been quite something. But it's a very rare bird, and we're very lucky to have it because it's used in the Second World War. Well, what we have here is the oldest piece of aircraft which we have in the museum. It's an Anzani rotary engine, made in 1912, and it puts out 45 horsepower. But what's special about it, the engine itself spins to keep the cylinders cool.
Well, hold up, the engine itself spins.
Yeah, the pedal sticks on it and the engine actually spins.
Okay, that's unique.
Well, that's how they did it until about 1924, when they finally found decent cooling systems so they didn't have to spin the engine. So what we have here is 1912, 106 years old, and would you believe it, the third engine is from 1939,
We have quite a strong connection with the Polish from the Second World War. We did embark on what was essentially a suicide mission for the Polish Home Army when they rose up to fight off the Nazi invaders and themselves to be liberated by Russia. They were considering themselves enemies of both. So they rose up themselves and embarked on an almost impossible mission to liberate themselves. But because they were brave enough to do that, and because the war started in Poland and Europe, the Allies decided that we had to assist them. So British, American, even a few Russian and South African pilots went on airdrops at rooftop level over Warsaw, and we lost a lot of pilots doing that, dropping supplies for the Polish Home Army. But they appreciated it so much that to this day they have annual commemorations thanking us. We also took in a few hundred British orphans from the war, and we still receive very generous gratitude from Poland for all of that. And we've got the Polish connection display just to show what was that. This chess set was made by a Polish soldier for Lasmat, a gift for Lasmat. And that portrait against Lasmat was a copy of a photograph of him, again, by a Polish soldier. All just showing their thanks for our contribution to their effort to liberate themselves in 1944. That's a Nazi flag captured by a Polish soldier during the war. And remnants of a crashed Liberator bomber that we were using to make those airdrops. this is a display showing the South African soldier who did more damage to enemy forces than any other South African soldier single-handedly in the entire Second World War. John Maseko won the military medal and had this portrait of him. This is a copy of the portrait that was commissioned of John Maseko. The original is in our library area. John Maseko was captured with thousands of South African soldiers in Tobruk. And he was taken to be a prison labourer at an Italian harbour. And while at that harbour, he used expertise he had with explosives that the Italians didn't know about. And he built a bomb out of a molten and stolen ammunition supplies he was unloading for the enemy. And he slowly, over time, built up a bomb in this molten. He made a fuse. He waited for the perfect target. And he planted the bomb in the ship, against the hull, at the risk of being shot if he was captured. And he detonated it. He managed to escape and sink that ship with everything on board single-handedly during the war. And that's how John Maseko became our most successful individual soldier of the Second World War. I'm the Edge Weapons Curator, and these are just a few select pieces, miscellaneous pieces that are my favourites from the Edge Weaponry Collection. So what we have, I'll just show you about a couple of them. We have a Japanese tachi, a sword from the 16th century. It's extraordinary how well made it is, how clean and flush it is, despite being so old. You can compare it to much more recent Edge Weapons, and you can see how tarnished those are by comparison to the Japanese tachi. On the very end there, we've got a Spanish bull bow. It's like the swords that would have been used in about the conquistadors, discovery of the New World. We have a Hindu kris at the top there that once belonged to the Sultan of Johor. The double mandarin swords are very familiar. This bayonet on the side of here is a Boer bayonet from the Boer War. Normally you see the British ones, you don't often see the Boer ones, they're quite rare. French gladius, kawakazashi as well, and that axe head over there is one that would have been used by either the Franks or the Vikings at those times when they were combat with them.
Young ladies, when you take them around, ward guys. We have two Russian rifles from the Second World War here, the bolt action machine gun and the semi-automatic Group Model 40, as used by Russian women snipers, the best of whom was Major Ludmila Pavlichenko, and she killed 309 German soldiers. And at this point, I advise the gentlemen to be afraid, to be very afraid. Russians discovered that women make better snipers than men because they are more patient. So in our First World War trench display, it basically gives some idea of the conditions under which men fought and died in the First World War. The most important aspect, of course, is the gas box, because the Germans introduced poison gas into warfare. And the first gas they used was chlorine gas, which kills you in a rather nasty way. It destroys the lining of your lungs, your body fluids rush into your lungs, and you drown in your own body fluids. And basically, these figures, one thing you learn as a soldier, any fool could be uncomfortable. And what we have here is, these guys have obviously made big precautions to keep comfortable, gloves, a brazier, and of course, in a trench, you paid attention. Out there in no man's land for snipers waiting for you to make a mistake. That's why the soldier has a periscope, so you can look into no man's land and not get beaten.
parked here in the yard. So we're actually going to find some cool information about some of the aircrafts and the artillery that's in the yard. So come follow me and let's go see if we can find David and Patrick. Except don't do that. All right, Patrick, okay. Where have you taken me?
I've taken you to a Mark 1-man German submarine. There's 6 left in the world. This is the only one that still has its torpedoes on it. But don't worry, these are practice hits. They can't explode.
Whew! Thank goodness.
But it's one of the few weapons of war that I know about, where you go to war on your own personal toilet seat. As they say, when you've got to go, you've got to go. And the pilot would be trapped in there for 10 to 20 hours. And so he could go, built into his pilot seat as a chemical toilet. Only problem is, these submarines were made badly, because it was the Germans were desperate when they made them. They leaked. And the level of water would rise in the pilot's compartment. And if he put anything into the toilet, and the water passed over the top of his seat, when he put it into the toilet, came back to him, he must not miss it.
We are our biggest First World War battle. Weighs 10 tons, and you need a caterpillar tractor to pull it. Guns like this, of course, are not enough to go into business. To give you an idea of the power, the shell landed here.
Yeah.
We have very fortunate relatives. They don't have to worry about it because there will be nothing left for them. This one survived because it was used for coastal defense in the Second World War. It's only a medium-sized First World War gun. In fact, the biggest British gun was weighed between 210 and 200.
Wow, that's heavy.
Okay. Our next stop is my favorite, especially for them.
Right.
Well, we are at our Sherman tank. I brought you here because my mother was an army doctor during the Second World War, and she could drive one of these things. She said she'd never been so tired of dirt in her life, but she could drive a 35-ton tank. The British called the Bronsons after their cigarette lights because, as they say, it lights first time every time. It got hit, the ammunition and fuel started to burn, and you had 20 seconds to get out. And if you were leaving around about the 17th second, you got back to the explosion. And but this, with the gun on this tank, it could kill a German Tiger tank. So that was
it. Hey Dave, where have you taken me? Because this thing looks menacing.
This is a Rhino, known as the G6 Howitzer or Rhino. It's a mobile gun, not a tank at all. Of course it's got the huge wheels that you see over there. This can go over 60 kilometers an hour off-road, but most interestingly, the G6 Howitzer can fire over Pretoria from here, well over 50 kilometers, but extremely long range, especially for
armored recovery vehicle, because tanks are big, you need a big tow truck to recover them without breaking down. And tanks will have a huge resistance, so you can very powerfully pull them out of that mess and pull it through the vehicle with the tank to a low bed and to the work of the vehicle. It actually isn't armed, it's all it's got for weaponry are smoke stoppers, or a smoke screen between you and the enemy. Thank you.
want to say thank you to Patrick. I want to say thank you to David for allowing us to come through. If you're new to my channel and you're watching this for the very first time, don't forget to hit the subscribe button that is sitting over here. Also, check out my latest video that's sitting over here. And if you like this video, give it a thumbs up. And also, I want to hear from you, so drop a comment in the comment section. And I will see you guys later. Cheers for now.